Hello, Nomads, and welcome to episode 79 of the Nomads of Fantasy. I am your host, Brandon, and I'm also here with... Who else is with me on my adventure? Oh, I see the great giant Dave.
Willow, you idiot!
that was pretty good.
Yeah, who is that? Revere?
Rizal.
Yeah, that was pretty good. Yep. And then I have my little sorcerer, Eric.
Oh, I'm really scared. No, don't. There's a peck with an acorn pointed at me.
Oh, man.
Yeah, these are quotes from the great, Eric, great movie, Willow.
We'll see about that.
Classic.
I think it came out, what, 1988?
88, yeah.
This is
the year was 1988.
This is a Ron Howard flick, but doing a little research, I knew that George Lucas wrote it. I didn't know that he actually wrote this before Star Wars. And I think originally called like Munchkins or something like that. Yeah. And, you know, he just couldn't get anybody to bite on it. I don't know. He just couldn't get into production. Star Wars happens. And then he revisits this because clearly he's a fan of Tolkien. Obviously, he's a fan of a lot of things. And he always likes to kind of pays tribute to the things that influences him with his movies. But I'm getting ahead of myself here with Willow. You can tell I'm excited. But other people are excited too, man. Like, we put it out on social and people had things to say about this movie.
If you want to follow us on social media, at Nomads of Fantasy on Twitter, yes, there were some other people who had some thoughts on this movie, such as Unadulterated Geek Talk says, "We say we will listen." Well, there you go. I hope you're listening to this episode right now.
Okay.
Sean Caster says, "An amazing film. I love it. I love it so." So What Happens Next said, "Did it early as an episode and was shocked. I had never seen it before. When it's not good, it's still fun. Hyped for the TV show."
Huh. Well, it's not good, it's still fun. I can't tell if they liked it or not.
Fun is the key word there. This is one of those movies I used to love, but it's been so long since I've seen it that I wonder how well it holds up. That's from Supreme Collector Nick. And Diabolical says, "Bevmorta will be tuning in and using her Terry Wogan wand mic to tell you her thoughts."
Bevmorta.
Yep.
She's a good villain in this. Not much redeemable from good old Bev.
Yep. That's good. So it sounded mostly positive, which is always nice to see. I'm definitely going to this movie with nostalgia. You know, I just watched this movie so much as a kid. So I'm sure some of the people who made comments were also probably from the same era and had the same relationship. But that's what's great.
That's why
Eric
I'm here.
I know Eric is much younger than Dave and I by... What is the actual age difference?
Well, I was born in 1994, so this movie came out 6 years before I was born.
Yeah, 13 years younger than us. So, okay. Yeah, so I'm curious to hear your opinion from somebody who was born after this movie came out.
Some of the things in this movie didn't age terribly well, but looking back with rose-colored glasses.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to have Eric's perspective on this, but we're pretty...
Don't worry, I won't. I won't be a wet blanket throughout the entire thing.
No, I know. You're typically more positive in general. So that's fine. You are your own person. And if you don't like something, you have problems with something, that's cool with me. But anyways, we're wrapping up November here. Well, we're like halfway, but with recording and the schedule and stuff like that, I think after this, we will be closing the month with the Ask a Nomad episode. So appreciate everybody who's been, you know, filling out the form or sending comments on Twitter and all that stuff. We got them all. I think Eric collected them all, so that's really cool. Looking like a fun episode. Is there anything else I'm missing, Dave? I know you're our schedule manager.
No, we're gonna be... Well, I mean, we're getting into November. We're getting into snowy season. I guess we can release the first episode of December is going to be on the wintry classic Hateful Eight. We're getting back into our Tarantino's roots. So that'll be an interesting one for everybody that wants to get that one in. And we'll release the rest of the schedule shortly, though.
I would say get started on The Hateful Eight sooner, because we were just talking about that. I've seen the movie. These two haven't. And I saw the theatrical cut, but it has since been expanded to, it looked like a television, like episodic.
Yeah, it's just like an extended edition on Netflix, I think. Okay. And yeah, you were saying it was like 8 hours long or something.
I don't know if it's 8 hours,
but it's broken up. It's broken up into, yeah, like 3 or 4 episodes, I think. So it's a little bit more manageable chunks. But it's a long movie to begin with, you know, just the theatrical cut is. But I would like to watch the extended version, because I've heard good things about it, actually.
Looks like it's about 4 hours long. It's four episodes at about an hour apiece.
Yeah, four hours is long.
That's
okay.
That's not too bad.
That's still a lot of film to get in. So
yeah,
if you go into it thinking of it as a TV show, though, it's really short. So that's how I'll go into it. It's only 4 hour long episodes. Yeah.
Or 8.5 hours. Yeah, however you want to frame it. All right, that's cool. What's after that, though, Dave? Is that Bahubali Part 2? Or no, that's Potter.
You're going to be gone, so we're getting in the Potter. Some Harry Potter while you are gone.
Should be fun. I want to start rewatching some of those, too.
Cram in 8 episodes, but it's a good... I think it's a great holiday flick, too, because there's a lot of Christmas tie-ins throughout the Harry Potter movies, too, which is pretty cool, because it's kind
especially the first one.
Yeah, there's some character building. There's always some holiday stuff, some ugly sweaters getting passed around. So, we'll be getting into Potter and then Bahubali at some point after that, and then we're kind of figure out a Christmas movie to put on the schedule, but we'll get that out at the end of the month.
Great. Well, I'm going to take my little rock here and throw it up in the air and watch it turn into a little birdie and take us to Act 2. And we have returned. We have arrived at the crossroads. And I think we can settle down and get ready to talk about Willow.
A little known fact that the Eric Clapton song Crossroads was about Willow. Little did you know, the Cream song.
Can't all tell about if Mad you're being Mardigan. Serious or not. I'm assuming that's a joke.
Nope. It came out probably about 10 years before.
That's where George Lucas got the idea.
That's where he got the inspiration came from. A little bit of Clapton, a little bit of Lord of the Rings. Yeah, you know.
So
sorry, I derailed you.
No, you're fine. let's just get this to frame up how this conversation is going to go. I think we need to extract how we feel about this movie going into it. Dave, let's start with you. Then me, then what?
I was going to say, let me go last.
Well, this one I've seen multiple times before. It's kind of a classic from growing up. I wouldn't say it's like Star Wars classics, but it's a classic. I don't know, because it's like a feel-good sword and sorcery adventure kind of thing. It's not... I mean, it is a little dark. There's people getting stabbed, and there's lots of, you know, people getting shot with arrows in the face and whatnot. But on the whole, it's kind of a lighthearted romp through fantasy land. But no, I liked it. I watched it with the family. The kids enjoyed it. 8-year-old liked it a lot more than the younger one. I think it's probably a little boring for a younger kid because there are some pacing things that happen throughout this movie where it gets slow for a bit and then you're sledding down a mountain and then it gets slow for a bit and, you know, all sorts of stuff. But I thoroughly enjoy this one. I could see coming to it now, having never seen it. I could see people having issues with some of the special effects. I could see people having an issue with some of the cheesiness as some of the jokes, but on the whole, it's a good, wholesome, little fantasy story. So definitely recommend it if people like the genre. It's one of them that, kind of holds up, and there's some special effects in it that were pretty friggin' groundbreaking for the time. Between the brownies and the shape-shifting and stuff like that. This is pre-Terminator 2000, before all that shit kind of got popular. So, I definitely like this one. This one was one I knew I was going to enjoy rewatching again, having not seen it in a while. And, it still holds up as a fun little fantasy romp. Over to you, Brandon. How about you? Do you watch with the fam?
I totally watched it. Okay.
Nice.
My 4-year-old and 8-year-old loved it.
Mm-hmm.
They had a blast with it. My wife enjoys this one. I enjoy this one. But we're kids that were born in the early 80s. So we were at the right age when this came out. I like it more as it gets older. As I get older. 80s had great charm in them. I'm thinking about some 80s movies, and I'm like, Big Trouble in Little China, Indiana Jones.
Yeah.
The lead is such a charming character. And I think Mad Mortigan and Willow are very charming in this movie, and it's wholesome to me.
Yeah.
So, and I think the special effects actually held up very well. I think they've enhanced some. I think Disney Plus has been tweaking it over the years, because I don't remember it looking so good. Like, yes, there are some limitations for this movie, but overall, for like a $30 million budget in 1988, I think, and this is Industrial Light Magic, right, that mm-hmm. produced this.
Mm-hmm.
So, I think it looks fine. I guess there's issues with the pacing. I don't see it because I grew up with this movie, so I just don't know any better. I don't know if it's good or bad because I just see Willow, fucking Willow, the movie I've seen since I was like 8 years old, right? So I don't know. But I am very curious for somebody who was born in the 90s to look at a movie from the 80s and the end of the 80s too, at the end of a pretty good run of adventure movies, but not too many fantasy movies. Legend, which was a couple years before 80s. This, I think, Labyrinth, and then this, so, but anywho, let's hear what Eric had to say, what he has to say.
Yeah, it's interesting to me because obviously, you say whatever movies that came out in the 80s or whatever, there's plenty of movies that I love that came out in the 80s, 70s, and before. Look at Star Wars, some of my favorite movies of all time. But yeah, obviously I don't have the nostalgia for this. I'm going in this, 2022 with fresh eyes, having never seen it before. It's a weird one for me. It's not like I hated it or anything. It was a fun movie, but overall, I thought it was a little boring, a little too long. It was 2 hours. When I saw that it was 2 hours long, I was like, damn, this is a long one. And like, as I was, especially the beginning, I think the second half is better. In my opinion, it picks up a little bit more with some of the story and some of the action and, stuff towards the end and the climax at the end and everything. But the beginning was a little boring for me.
It was a last slow night. First hour. You get like the intro to the village and all that crap.
I was watching it last night and I was struggling very hard to stay awake. Like, I was just sitting on the couch with my wife watching this movie, and I like fell asleep and woke up like 3 times, had to rewind. And I'm like, I can't do it. I can't finish it tonight. So left it for tonight, and I finished the last hour today. But no, it was fun overall. I think, like you said, it's a feel good fantasy movie. And I feel like traditionally I like fantasy, but I'm maybe lean more towards like dark fantasy is more of what I like, instead of like, fairies and magic and, what I mean? Stuff like that. And it felt, I guess I was maybe expecting a little bit more because I knew you guys loved it so much and hyped it up so much, but maybe, I'm sure that's a lot of nostalgia talking. So you guys, there's things from my past that I love that you guys would probably think is boring as well.
Right. Totally. That's how it is.
But yeah, that's kind of what I'd say. Like I said, I definitely don't hate it. I enjoyed the story overall and enjoyed watching it, but I just found it.
What did the wife think about it?
She didn't. She wasn't a huge fan. Nope. She thought it was boring. She didn't finish it with me. She watched the first like hour 45 with me as well, and she was asleep. And she was like, nah, boring. And I'm like, eh. So I just finished it on my own.
Okay, well, let's talk about, I guess, some of the characters. Warwick Davis is playing the lead, Willow. What did you think of his performance?
I mean, as the character.
And he's like 17 years old in this role. It's his first.
Is he really? Okay.
Real role.
He seemed really young, but yeah.
And you don't see many people working where the lead talent is a little person.
Is a little person. No, I can respect that.
And you got to think about those lot. Camera shots that they were doing. Like, they had to literally get. There's some shots where you're looking up at him. Think about that. You think the camera crew is all little people? It's probably normal sized people.
Right.
Holding the camera low and all that stuff. So I was just thinking about the production throughout this movie.
Yeah, the perspective shots and like, yeah, especially in the village in the beginning, because it's all little people in the village.
Yeah.
And like the camera is pretty close to the ground. I never really thought about that. But yeah, Willow as a character, I think Warwick Davis knocks it out of the park with the character that he's trying to embody. You know, like this random farmer from this random village goes on this epic quest to save this kingdom. You know, it's the unlikely hero story, which, you know, is always fun. So I think,
like that he's like, I forget every time though, he's, because you always think about him like cherishing the baby and protecting the baby, but in the beginning of the movie he's like, leave it,
push it down the river,
push it down the river.
Come on,
that was pretty good.
Get rid of it.
He's so selfish in the beginning. He's like, I don't want anything to do with it.
Don't go near it, we don't know where it's been.
But Dad, it's a baby. Not like us.
No, it's not an Elwyn. Looks like a Daikini baby.
What's a Daikini?
Daikinis are big giants who live far away.
Oh, she's so cute. Can't we keep it, Dada?
No. We'll push it downstream and forget we ever saw it. Come on. Shh, it's the prefect. That's all I need. Keep it quiet. Don't touch it.
Yeah, he's just trying to get his farm, trying to get his shit straight. He got burgle cut, busting his balls every chance he could get. That guy was a fucking piece of work.
Is that guy the actor that plays the Oompa Loompas in Willy Wonka in the Chocolate Factory? I swear that's the same guy, because there's in Willy Wonka, there's the one guy that plays all the Oompa Loompas. I don't know if it was Burgle Cut, but it looked like him.
I don't think it is. He doesn't have any credits underneath his IMDb page.
Burgle Cut. I hated that character when I was little.
He's such a prick.
But as I get older, he like steals the show for me, man. He is so animated. Is his acting great? Absolutely not. But it's so over the top. It's just, I love it. It's the way he threatens.
He's a bossy Willow. Asshole, yeah.
Oh my god.
That's good. You still haven't paid your debts to me. Where did you get these thieves?
Well, maybe I used magic.
You're no sorcerer, Afgood. You're a clown. I sell the plant seeds around here. Now tell me where you got them.
My family's been gathering them in the forest since last fall. There's no law against that Mr. Burgle Cut.
Willow, you didn't leave them along by the river.
Magic? You'll need magic to expect to get your planting done before the rain start. I will have this land, Ufgood, and you're gonna end up working in the mines.
Or how he throws them under the bus, where, like, you know, when they're trying to decide who's gonna go, and they're like, I think it should be the guy who found it, and he just immediately points to Willow, and
And he laughs like an asshole after everything he says. After everything he says.
Like, leans forward and pushes head up, and he's just... It's like licking my throat as I laugh. It's like cackle.
One thing I was thinking about, Brandon, I know obviously this is nostalgic for you, but Willow's kids, fucking horrible kid actors. Terrible.
Oh, they're brutal. But think about this.
I mean, they're really young too.
Like, you know how I feel about kid actors. I think all kid actors are bad. I think those kids are adorable.
And yeah, of course.
Absolutely.
I'm sure they were super young. Like, I can't.
I think they picked them because they were, you know, they were little people and they were kids. And again, the industry just does not have roles in stuff like that for people like this. So what acting chops are they bringing?
I was thinking about that as well. Like, they had to get all of these little people actors, and like, there's only so many you can choose from, you know? So they probably had to take what they could get as far as the talent that they were kind of given. So that's something I was thinking about as well, but
yeah.
I think Val Kilmer's character, Mad Mardigan, is definitely the highlight of this movie for me.
Oh yeah.
So John Cusack apparently was going for this role and he lost it to Val Kilmer. And Val Kilmer was like, he did like, you know, Top Secret. He did Top Gun and then he did this. He was just get whatever he wants.
Cusack ain't getting this from Kilmer. No way. Absolutely.
No way.
Would have been
a completely
different character for sure. Like,
yeah. He doesn't
get that. If you think it's boring, that watching it now.
Oh yeah.
nothing against that actor, but
he flashes that roguish smile and he melts your heart the same way Han Solo does when he like smirks at like the blast door is not opening. Like, it's the same like charm and likability that he brings to the character, even though, you know, he's kind of a scumbag a little bit too.
Yeah.
Scoundrel, if you will.
A scoundrel. He's a scamp. Yeah.
I think it's obvious that Lucas made Han Solo and he made Mad Mardigan, and you can tell that it's the same. What did I say?
You said Mardigan. It's
Mardigan. Oh, I'm sorry. Mad Mardigan.
Mad Mardigan. And
that Mardigan is his brother. Mad Mardigan. that he made both of those characters. So, you know, like, all right, I can see him making I can see him making that character again because it's such a great character. But you can tell that there's Indiana Jones. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
There's Lord of the Rings in this.
Of course.
You know, the Fellowship of the Ring, wizards, little people, forests, you know, dragons, all that stuff. How could you not?
It's easy to make that comparison. And I sort of made that comparison as well. And like, I was thinking, I do like the world of Willow that he created. Obviously, it takes inspiration from many other fantasy things, and I think that was maybe my issue with it, is that I've seen things like this before that have done it better, and like Fellowship is obviously the easy comparison there, but obviously this came before, so it's hard to compare.
Do you guys think that Peter Jackson was influenced and paid some homage to Willow? Because if you look at the Fellowship of the Ring, when Sauron and Saruman fight, it's just like the two old ladies.
The witch battle? I thought of that during.
And I'm like, dude, this is. I mean, there's some scenes in this that I think, like, man,
I can see it.
But like, not to say that Willow is an influential movie. I'm sure it has some things that it's done to the industry, but I'm just saying, like, I think Peter Jackson probably liked this movie.
The OG witch battle. Or at least definitely, I wrote down, like, that it's specifically a call out to the Saruman Gandalf fight, basically like the spell war back and forth of them trying to outspell each other. I don't know what you call it when wizards battle.
Wizard battle.
Okay.
No, but I could definitely see that some parts in there.
I mean, like the baby beam going down the river, you know,
everything takes inspiration from something else. And whether Peter Jackson did or not, I think, if he did, he built off of it successfully, because there's definitely some of those ideas in this movie, and like, again, like I said, things we've seen in fantasy before, but, you know, I don't know.
This happened in 1988, though, so all the fantasy stuff you've seen is probably based off of Willow.
Every fantasy thing is based off of Willow, yes, because nothing came before it.
Nope. But I mean, like, how many fantasy like things did you get like back then, like before Willow? Like, I don't know, there's not a lot of, like we were saying before, there's like Labyrinth and some other, I guess, some the, other
Legend.
You probably
haven't seen that. I think it's a really Scott flick with Tom Cruise and it's Tim Curry, and it's pretty
that one's really good, but I will,
yeah.
That one just scared the shit out of me as a kid. That's all I remember, really.
Oh, speaking of that as well, I was thinking, like, this movie is rated PG, but there's some, I mean, the whole story of this movie is pretty dark for a PG rated movie.
Killing moms and babies looking for.
Right at the beginning, the queen's is rounding up pregnant ladies to try to, you know, figure out which baby is the prophecy that's going to destroy her and trying to kill the baby. I'm like, damn, this starts out really dark.
I was thinking about that. I watch this movie, but I'm not paying attention. I'm like, yeah, you know, I know how it goes. She wants to get him. But I'm thinking about it, like, damn, that's actually really fucked up.
Right?
And even like the lady that helps baby Alana, was it?
Yeah, whatever. Princess escape. Alana, yeah.
She like pushes it down the river, then immediately gets mauled by like rabid dogs. Yeah, pig or boars or whatever they are. Like she's immediately gets eaten alive. And I'm like, oh, that's pretty fucked up too. And then.
Well, you guys watched this with your kids. Was there any like. Because there's some scary scenes, I would say.
This one scene that scared my wife for sure, because she screamed. She's like, oh. But it was during the big battle with the trolls, and one of them jumped out, and she like...
The one that jumped down from the ceiling or something.
A little jump scare, yeah.
Yeah.
I was going to say,
the kids are cool with everything.
My kid's three, and he's very sensitive to stuff, so there's no way I could watch this with him, because it's a PG movie, but there are some, you know, more intense scenes, I guess.
It's funny that you say that. My four-year-old loves to repeat one-liners or whatever, and who the hell are you? And what the hell is that? Or something like that. It's just always something, what the hell, or who the hell.
Picks out the good one.
Yeah, and this is like they say it in the movie a few times. It's like a little gag in the throughout the movie, and Ryan repeated it each time. I'm like, we just look at each other and laugh, and I'm like, I don't know. We'll just let it go, because if we make a big deal out of it, he'll remember. He's just repeating stuff out of the movie, but but yeah, there's some dark stuff in it. There's some violence in it, but overall, I mean, come on, that song, that theme song.
I was just gonna say
the music was really good.
I mean, Rotten Tomatoes gives us like a 56, and I'm like, you fucking suck. No way it's that low.
No,
56, 58 or something like that. I'm like, the song alone keeps it in the 70s.
Yeah, James Horner is the guy that did the music. Apparently he died in a plane crash when he was like 61, but he did he did the score for Aliens. He did the score for Avatar.
Yeah. Wow.
Deep Impact, Mask of Zorro, Amazing Spider-Man, Beautiful Mind. Like he did
the Star Trek movie.
Yep.
I think the
couple Retcon. Star Trek movies. Yeah. So
that's impressive. It's definitely it's got such an upbeat, like heroic, like
it feels adventurous.
Going on an adventure kind of vibe to it that every time, like, you know, an action scene's about to start up and that thing picks up, that song kicks in. You're like, yeah, dude, fuck yeah.
I love the theme songs from Star Wars, Indiana Jones, Willow, Back to the Future, and Jurassic Park.
And Goonies.
And Goonies, thank you.
Goonies is a good one.
Yeah. Dude, I just love movie theme songs, and this one's up in the top 20, hands down. I love this song. And I'm glad it's throughout the whole movie. But all right, so that's the characters. That's the song. What about the production, Eric? We look at Lord of the Rings and we look at Star Wars, and between there was a movie called Willow. It's made from George Lucas's team. It's from his mind. It's Howard's on the film. Everything's there. For the most part, I think visually it looks pretty good. I couldn't imagine at the time. I bet it probably looked incredible with the...
Oh, yeah, at the time, for sure.
The CG that they added, that's early CG. You didn't really see that in movies.
I think it holds up pretty well. Again, there's some... Whatever. It's just an effect of the time. It's just some of the stuff. The only thing that I really noticed that didn't look the best and it was ambitious for the time was, like, the brownies. And because some of the stuff, it just looked like they were plastered over a fucking JPEG or something. You know, I'm like, whatever.
But you got to think, like, they're probably like green screening that and then.
Right. Yeah. For the time
of everything.
For the time.
Some shots are better than others. Like in all the ones, it's great.
All the ones that are close up are good. Like far away where they're like in shots with other characters, you can tell they're just superimposed on a flat screen. Which is fine, but whatever. It's expected for the time. Some of the shots that actually I was really impressed with were some of the big, like, castle shots.
the matte paintings.
And yes,
so good. Like all that stuff. I saw the
especially Bev Morta's castle at the end. It's like huge, yeah, and I'm like, damn, that actually looks really, really good.
That's a painting. That's so you 80s said?
Evil fantasy.
Oh yeah,
yeah, for sure. Yeah. You can go on YouTube and you can see what's originally shot, and then they mask it out, and then they paint in the background.
Oh, so, like, that's sweet.
Her massive. I was like, man, her courtroom is really big for a studio set, but it's not. It's a matte painting.
Yeah, like that stuff is like seamless.
I didn't even notice it.
It's just, yeah, it looked really good.
Yeah, if you go back when they total Lord of the Rings like shot where you're like really low and you're looking up and they're going across a little bridge and you see mm-hmm. just a silhouette of that, again, it's just shot like in a building and then they just painted everything else around it and it's so mm-hmm. seamless. Honestly, if you, for what it's worth, this movie goes all over the place. It is a rather epic, as far as visually, regardless of pacing and story. If you just look at where they go and the places they experience, there are a lot of sets, lot of visuals in this. They got snow, they got all that stuff. They got castles, they got
starting off.
Even
the
deleted scene had a really cool production thing. I guess they couldn't get the thing in the water to work, but
yeah, it was a very ambitious movie. For sure. Like you said, it feels epic. It does feel like you're going on this grand adventure with these characters, you know, through this fantasy land. And, you know, it makes their mission, their quest, I should say. It does. It feels epic. It feels like an important adventure for Willow and everything. So I can really appreciate the scope of the movie and just the ambition of it.
Can you appreciate the comedy in this movie?
The comedy is a little cheesy.
You didn't think how about the wizard? Like when they're in that room and he's like him and Bilbo. Him and Willow. They like throw the, was it bones, Dave?
Yeah.
What is he?
Yeah, that part got me a little bit. It was like the bones tell me nothing. That was good. I like that.
I will consult the bones. The bones tell me nothing.
And Virgo cut when he's just like, we can't send our top fighter. And then he's just like, every group needs a leader. And then they say, Virgo cut, you'll lead. And then he turns around instantly and calls for the
he just like, a look at the camera and he does like the yell, no. That was like they try and use the brownies throughout. I didn't think the brownies were really that funny. I was more of like,
they are horrible.
They were kind of annoying. My wife and
kids enjoyed them a lot, but I think they hurt the movie.
Like Mad Mardigan's, like that's where I'm coming in. Like some of his one-liners.
Oh yeah.
His side
everything he did, I was on board with. some of the stuff I rolled my eyes at, but other than that, I thought it was fine overall. I know I mentioned the action a little bit. It's, I don't know, it's that like PG George Lucas-y action, you know, like, and a lot of the choreographed scenes were, I don't know, it just felt old, you know, like, like people are kicking the air and they make the noise, but they don't make contact.
There was a couple of Wilhelm screens in this one too.
Yeah, there's a couple.
There was like at least two that I counted and I'm like, okay.
So I know exactly what you're talking about and like. It's interesting hearing your perspective on this because I fucking love that and I miss that.
I think that's one of the reasons I feel like I felt the same way that I feel about this movie that I felt about Indiana Jones watching it for the first time.
Okay.
Because I'm going to slam all your childhood nostalgia.
Do you not like Indiana movies. Jones?
I've only seen Raiders and I watched it, I don't know, 5 years ago and I was meh on
that
it.
That is incredible. I did not know that.
Temple of Doom and Last Crusade are some quality flicks, too.
I think that's one of the greatest movies ever made.
I don't know. Wow. Maybe I need to watch the other ones, but I...
No, man, it's cool.
Because I think it's just the effect of, like, not having watched it for so long, hearing people over the years talk about how amazing it is. It's so hyped up. And then it just, you know, it doesn't live up to my expectations. But I would say I probably enjoyed Willow more than I enjoyed Indiana Jones.
Wow. good for Willow. Okay. Well, I mean, I don't know.
But it's that same type of like cheesy action, you know. I don't know. There's just something about it that I'm like, okay, when's this?
Like Indiana Jones is
this is just boring. Boring action to me.
Indiana Jones is mostly like fist fights and barroom brawls and like, you know, gags like that. This one, like when the...
It's hard with this one because they're like stabbing people, but it's rated PG. So they're not really like... There's no blood. They're not really, you know... They like put the sword into their stomach and then the guy just falls over. I don't know.
Yeah. There is a lot of that. Like when they're storming the castle and it's just Mad Mardigan and Willow in there. Like that is one of I don't know, my favorite scenes from the whole movie because it's Mad Mardigan just going crazy. Like
in the his sword work is good for you know, pretty boy actor.
The choreography is good. I think no problem with that. Some
of the sword tricks that he does too are good. He does like that sword flip where he flips it to himself.
That is cool, yeah.
Like that's classic.
He's a cool guy for that. He gets some cool guy points for that.
You didn't like the tavern escape where they're on the horse chase?
Oh, that was awesome.
That's the
too.
Part where I fell asleep.
Oh, really? I like that scene. I think it's pretty well done.
Again, it's fun.
It's stupid.
It's fine.
It's so stupid. There's
it goes
no reason
on
why,
too
like,
long.
They should have just killed the horses in the front and then killed them in the back.
Well, yeah, I wasn't even thinking of that. I didn't think of that.
These
at
are
all.
The worst knights of all, or whatever they are. I think they're knights. I don't know.
I think
queens.
I think
guard.
It was fun. It was. It could have been shorter. The brownies are just rolling around.
But they got the, you know, they had to the cut the barrel thing. To save them from that one guy. But it was hilarious.
As a kid, I remember loving that scene. I was just like, "Yeah, that's so cool. The little guys did something."
When Willow goes into the room and he turns around and Mad Mardigan's wearing like a woman's dress and he's about to hide from the husband.
Oh, the boy!
And the husband's trying to hit on her like in front of his other wife, which was also weird. But and then all of a sudden,
right in front of his wife.
And they pull the thing off his face and. Not a woman, and then
not
he starts,
a woman.
He starts the whole brawl.
Not
again.
A woman takes like, out everybody. Either.
Obviously, guy, like holy shit! But you see Val Kilmer's like beard underneath his thing that he's holding up over his face. He's got the 5 o'clock shadow.
But oh, so funny!
It is good,
and like obviously, I know this movie's not winning any Oscars for its story or anything, but I also found everything pretty predictable. You know, how the story was going to go, which again is fine because it's again, it's a fun movie. It's not winning any Oscars for its writing or whatever, but I knew how it was all going to go. I could kind of see it when I picked it up back to watch the rest of the hour. I'm like, okay, obviously they're going to get captured or the baby's going to get taken away and then they're going to have to escape. And I was like, okay, well, whatever. I was along for the ride.
There were some accolades thrown upon this movie though. It didn't win an Oscar, but it was nominated for multiple Academy Awards for sound effects and editing and visual effects.
I was gonna say probably for the production.
Lost both of them to Who Framed Roger Rabbit, which was also done by Industrial Light and Magic.
I was just gonna say like the last of themselves.
That's funny, right?
It won best costume design at Saturn Awards, which is pretty cool. Warwick Davis was nominated for Best Performance by a Younger Actor, but lost to Fred Savage, that little son of a bitch. Jean Marsh was for Best Supporting Actress. She was Queen Bev Mordia, but she lost to Sylvia Sidney for Beetlejuice. So it seems like there was a lot going on that year. It lost Best Fantasy Film at the Hugo Awards, lost to Who Framed Roger Rabbit, nominated for two... Oh, here you go, Eric. It's also nominated for two Golden Raspberry Awards, including Worst Screenplay, which it lost to Cocktail, and Worst Supporting Actor.
That's good.
For Bill Barty, who played
who the hell is that?
He played the old wizard from the from their town,
from the village.
Yeah.
Oh, he also was in He-Man, Master of the Universe, or whatever. Mm. Right.
So. But no, there was a lot of talk around it, like the visual effects and stuff like that, like the what do they call it the digital morphing or whatever,
rotoscoping.
From like
the morphing.
Animals to like that was like cutting edge for the time then, like that was
okay
hot shit.
I will say the part where Queen Bev Morda was transforming them into pigs, that was pretty creepy.
I think that was all practical though, like
yeah, that was practical, but that was pretty scary. It
Yeah, I would have been scared watching that as a kid. Like,
yeah, I'm trying to remember if that scared me, but yeah, it's a creepy scene. What do you think of the dragons, the double headed dragon? That did you like? I mean, stop motion. Like,
it was
88.
Yeah, stop motion. I think it looked for stop motion. It looked really good. I thought, you know, it had good effect, good scale. It reminded me of like a, you know, a Rancor. Or something.
It did
like
have
that,
all those faces.
But better animated. Yeah. I don't know why all like those stop motion creatures have like a similar face like, look and like the eyes
the
and everything.
The face was like all tucked in on itself. I didn't even call it a dragon. I don't even know what I wouldn't know what to call it.
Well,
they call it like the Siskel Ebert thing or something. They named it after Siskel and Ebert. It's like some Siskel and Ebert pun.
Oh. Huh.
Well, it was like, I was like, what the fuck is going on? Because Willow transforms the troll. He casts like the spell on the troll, and it fucking like melts into a pile of meat.
Yeah,
and
that's
then
the
two
scene
heads
that scared
little
my wife.
Two heads little sprout out, and then he just kicks it into the water, and it turns into this dragon thing. And I'm like, what the fuck is going on?
And then like 10 seconds later, you have like Matt Mardigan in front of everybody doing some cool sword things, like yelling at everybody, and all of a sudden this thing just pops out of the water, and it's like huge already, and it starts eating
again. I know,
and then he runs out. Come on, do you like the joke? He like runs out with the army. He's scared with them, and then he's just standing.
No, that
like,
was funny.
Get him.
I guess I will say the jokes landed more than they missed. There was a couple I rolled my eyes at, but there was some good ones that I chuckled at. I did think it. Whatever. I guess the worst effect, probably that looking effect, was when Mad Mardigan was riding on the dragon. I just thought it didn't look very good at all.
Oh, but
again,
okay.
How do you? It's hard to superimpose a fucking real human on top of a stop motion.
I know. There's a shot
animated figure.
There's a shot that I see every time I watch it. It makes me laugh. It's so it's when it's. We could probably talk about this one scene, but it's when they're going down the on a shield, escaping that camp
on the mountain.
They got captured.
Oh, the sledding scene?
Yeah, you know, and all the stuff. So you have Mad Mardigan holding the back of Willow and the baby. They're going down. He falls off. And then you see Willow is alone on the shield sliding into the other little camp of the other army. But you can tell it's literally just, they just let a shield, like a little sled go down the hill with a guy on it. But it's not a real person. It is so stiff.
I noticed that too. I'm like, they just sent a dummy down a hill on a sled.
It looks so much like a dummy. It's so bad. It's like a 2 second shot, but you can just tell it's not a real person. It makes me laugh.
With that scene, it did make me laugh.
The cartoonish scene
when Mad Mardigan come down in the big old snow boulder. That made me laugh because it was so ridiculous. It was like straight out of a cartoon.
So George Lucas likes to do cartoonish scenes though. He does that with Han Solo like running it after like 20 stormtroopers with a gun, and then they turn around and he's like 100 of them. He's like, oh, and he runs away. Or when Indiana Jones is you haven't seen this, but when Indiana Jones is escaping
spoiler warning,
crashing airplane in the beginning of Temple of Doom, Indiana Jones Temple of Doom, they get on a raft for the water. They jump out and land on a mountain with that. There's some ridiculous in George Lucas's writing, and I think this scene here specifically, he just feels he has to do something cartoonish,
because
it comes out of nowhere. Everything else is more or less grounded, you know. But
something else, I'm not gonna complain the whole time, but this is a weird one for me because I did enjoy part of this. So the whole love story between Mad Mardigan and Sorsha.
Yeah.
I thought it was funny that Mad Mardigan got like high off the fucking pixie dust or whatever, the love dust. Like that part was pretty funny. And he goes into Sorsha's tent and he's, you know, spouting off all this like romantic talk. I love you, you know. I'm, what was this quote?
You're
like
my sun and my moon, or my moon and my stars, or.
Dude,
yeah, like
I love it.
In eternal darkness without you.
He walks up to her and he says, like, I love you. And then he starts walking away. But then he like turns around and just instantly like in love. Like a cartoon character. I think it was well acted.
Good.
I think he hams it up. It's cheesy. He's definitely having fun in the role. And he does all that poetry. I love it so good. And you got even the brownies and Willow are like, no, what are you doing?
doing?
All this stuff. Mm-hmm. But then she, like, is sleep. She's all about it. Sleep.
It deprives me of your beauty. The beauty of your eyes.
One move, jackass, and you really will be a woman.
You are my sun, my moon, my starlit sky. Without you, I dwell in darkness. I love you.
What are you doing here?
Your power has enchanted me. I stand helpless against it. Come to me now. Tonight, let me worship you in my arms.
Get away from me!
I love you.
Stop saying that!
How can I stop the beating of my heart? It pounds like never before.
Out of fear.
Out of love.
I can stop it. I'll kill you.
Death next to love is a trivial thing. Your touch is worth 100,000 deaths.
He's a handsome guy, so she's just like... She's
I don't know. That was the part that I thought was rolling my eyes at.
It's
because
cheesy.
Every movie back then had to have like a love story, you know?
Yeah.
Or like some romantic thing between a man and a woman.
They needed a couple more scenes together for this to happen. It kind of just...
It was too fat. Yeah, it was too fat. Because she was like the complete opposite side.
Oh, you know what it was?
It was fighting.
He says it's a fighting, and he says a smooth thing. She's like, what are you looking at? Your leg. I want to break it.
Oh, you can tell there's a couple times during him like defending
some sexual tension.
The castle where he's just going balls wild, like putting himself on catapults and flinging himself across the castle and then jumping on the dragon. Then he falls down. It's a panty dropper. She could not resist it.
I was going to say, and then right after that, he walks up to her and she just makes out with him.
Yep.
I'm like, okay.
Well, hold on a second. So there is a thing I noticed this time watching it. So when the Queen's guard finally goes down to the other little village in the snow and they are looking for the baby. Was it Sorcia? Is that her name?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Sorcia goes down the stairs. They capture her. Turn around, you see like three or four other guards in the stairs. And they basically like have the knife next to her throat and says, back up and get out of here.
Mm-hmm.
So they do. But then they just keep her and hide in that room and think about how they're going to get out. I don't understand. Wouldn't those three guys that just saw her get captured tell everybody that they're in there with her, with the baby? They're just running around crossing the muck out there looking
true.
For them specifically. It's a weird scene. I've never noticed it, but I was like,
I didn't notice that until now.
Is it? And she's like, yeah, it is weird. I'm like, it is weird. I don't know. Maybe something was edited out. I have no idea. Or they were like in that room hiding. I have no idea, but yeah, interesting.
Huh.
I was thinking about like, whatever. Obviously, Willow and Mad Mardigan didn't mean to, slide into that village on their sled, but they're the ones that brought the army there, and these poor villagers are just getting slaughtered.
Saw
just
that.
Because they rolled into town.
Well,
they already
had the other army there too. Like they were already hiding them there too, so they know what's going on. Yeah. Apparently, I don't know.
True, but I was like, oh, these poor villagers—they're just caught in the middle of this fucking war. I'm like, well,
yeah, they're fine.
Casualty of war.
Don't live on the mountain.
Don't live on the mountain.
I think one of the stronger parts, and I think this is why you like the second half of this movie more than the first half, is because Mad Mardigan and Willow are starting to get along. Initially they didn't. Like the first time they meet, it's kind of funny. He says like they don't know that he's in that cage at the crossroad, that he's like just hanging there. And then he grabs Willow when he backs into him. He's like, get me water, Peck, or die, or you'll die. Like, but he lets him go. Like, how are you going to die? Like,
yeah, right.
He's not going to do anything.
That's what
there's
I was
no
thinking
threat.
That too.
Like, what a stupid line to say, especially when you're trying to get water from these guys.
It's weirdly racist towards the little people in this movie.
Everyone is.
Oh yeah,
everybody's
of course.
Got it. Yeah, very very down talky. Peck is like it's a very
like a
nasty
slang.
Derogatory term towards them, which.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't like it, but I don't know. It's like
it's world building.
I was gonna say you can't use real world slurs and things like that. So But yeah,
but like
that,
yeah, I did.
But then like he like gets the baby, he loses the baby, all that stuff. They go through the thing, and then like he gets it back, and he's like mad at him and all that stuff. And then they get stuck together after that wagon chase and all that stuff. But like I think it's the being captured that bonds them, right?
Well, yeah, because I was
they're arguing about like that Blackroot was... or something like that. Like, you can't have a baby of Blackroot. Like, why? Like, mm-hmm. My mother gave us Blackroot.
Yeah, that's definitely one of the things that one of the, like you said, the stronger parts of the story anyways, is the relationship between Willow and Mad Mardigan. Because you do see it develop a little bit more and they're like, you know, starting to trust each other more. And the part that got me was when, yeah, like you said, when they got captured and Willow, you know, they're dragging him up the mountain.
Clearly he can't keep up.
He's struggling to keep up, and Mad Mardigan just throws him up on his shoulders. I'm like, yeah, guy. I like that.
It's mm-hmm, a scoundrel yeah. with a heart of gold.
Starting to come around, exactly. You know, baby's growing on him. He's growing mm-hmm. on him.
That is,
you know,
pretty good the way that they tie that in throughout the movie, though. Like every time there was like a one-liner or a scene or something happened, there was so many baby reaction shots. We're like, the baby would giggle, or the baby would frown.
Baby's
or the baby
a good
would
actor.
Look confused.
Seriously, like, the baby would give like dirty looks,
there
or like
so
fucking,
many like
yeah, there was
so
some
many
good
looks
ones.
From the baby, which I thought was just weird to have it like so interspersed. Like the baby had a personality, even though it didn't have a word. But
right,
Laura Danham had an attitude and a personality to her, which was kind of interesting for
yeah,
a baby.
I don't know I don't know how they got those shots. If they were just like. Trying to get different reaction, like doing these one-off shots with the baby, trying to get different reactions, and then editing. Why can't I say that word? Editing them in wherever they fit, you know.
Even
but they, I think they did a really good job with that.
One eyebrow raise, or it was like a like
yeah,
a
some good expressions.
And I'm like, wow, that is very emotive for a baby.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that is interesting. Yeah, even screaming. To be honest, like they had at the final scene that the baby's screaming. Head off
mm-hmm.
But I don't know, I like the, that's probably like I said, like why you like the second half, because at that point they're full-on buddies, they're yelling at each other a little bit, you know, like he's calling them out, I love you, I would never say that, yeah, I love you, you're my mood, you're my light, you were saying all these things, he's like, I said that stuff, why would I say that, you know, and just like the back and forth is starting to pick up, but then towards the later on, like Mad Mardigan is just always there to save him, and he does some cool ass mm-hmm. shit, like when he's fighting all those guys at that Cass has got that ridiculous outfit on with the thing covered. I think it's stupid, like in the helmet.
Oh yeah,
like it's like over his nose. I'm sure it's.
Oh yeah,
I'm sure it's based on something, but it's just it looks so stupid, in a fun way.
He probably thought he looked so cool.
Yeah, like he would.
Probably thought he
He's
looked
like,
so
yeah.
cool.
Yeah, but like he like cuts the catapult thing and like shoots over. Then he like yells at the troll. Troll design's not the best at
no.
all.
Yeah,
I think at that time
it reminded me of like a fucking like the
like a Saturday Night Live
yeah like Planet of the Apes or
Planet
something.
Of the Apes but you know then he instantly fights that dragon, he jumps on it, you know, and does the cool sword through the thing, and I don't know, it's all that stuff is cool, and I don't know, I just like that he's protecting him, and then when the baby does get kidnapped, you feel, you know, you feel bad because.
Mm-hmm.
It's gonna get
Willow Warwick Davis is killed. Giving his best. He falls to the ground. It took her. And Marigan, it's like, but he's got at that point he's got the woman, right?
Yeah, and all of a sudden she runs over and she's like so worried about Willow. All of a sudden, I'm like, come on, you were just trying to kill him.
That's
like
what
five
I was thinking
ago.
Too. Yeah, she does a huge. She does a really.
It's a
really
hard.
Fast
it's a hard
flip.
Turn right there. But mm-hmm. I mean, she's in love all of a sudden, so you know. It's a kind of thing. But then, yeah, we get to go to the Bavmorda Castle, which is a cool scene where, you know, everybody gets turned to pigs and Willow's got his comeuppance where he proves that he's a great sorcerer and he turns Finn from, like, what was she then? She was a crow to a couple different things and then into a human finally.
Into a goat.
She was a goat for a bit. Yep.
Yeah, and then she was going through her whole transformation process when Willow was transforming her back into a human. She was like a turtle and then an ostrich. And
a peacock and a tiger. There's a couple things in there.
Yep. That I think that is one thing that I liked about the story like Willow, obviously, he is an aspiring sorcerer and he's learning a little bit more throughout. But I thought, you know, I thought it was going to be more predictable that like by the end he would be like, you know, all powerful, fucking zapping fools left and right. But I liked that he was still, by the end, he was still like
reserved,
an apprentice. And like he there was a lot for him to learn. Still, you know,
which makes the new series.
I appreciated that.
It's like Luke, as a little bit. You can see him becoming the Jedi Master, but never be actually being that, like, because he, you know, Luke just becomes a fucking tight black shirt wearing Jedi Master in the, like, episode six. But, like, you know, you see him kind of growing and you know, like, even the,
yeah,
A New Hope,
the progression.
He doesn't do shit. He just feel, he just senses the Force and trusts his, you know, trusts in the Force and stuff like that. But, with Willow,
I like that.
Yeah,
they could have easily made him by the end like the most powerful sorcerer in the world or whatever.
So I'll say this, man. I wrote a couple things about this movie in retrospect that like I think makes this movie awesome. Has a great theme song, gorgeous locations. Mm-hmm. It's got dragons. It's got sword fights, horse fights, trolls, castles, fights in the rain. It's got brownies. It's got fairies. And it has two old ladies punching the shit out of each other. So
they were going
like,
at it.
You could, that was like, a good when battle. Do you see two old ladies going at it? And like, I'll say that this is probably one of the few times you'll see it. And I like it. And I'm for it. And
that,
Willow,
out of context,
just,
that could sound really funny. How often do you see Willow, two old ladies going at it?
She's like, warns them too. I think it's cool. She's just like, Willow, you don't have to go any further at this point. And I was like, damn, old lady, what are you going to fucking do? She's so confident with herself. She just shows up in white. You know, the lady's in black. It's totally out of Lord of the Rings. Whatever. And it's raining. Yeah, the other lady's like, her time is running out. So she's just like using all of her magic. She's ready to kill her own daughter. She's whatever. She just needs that baby to be, I don't know, zapped up. Who knows what's supposed to fucking happen. But, and I like that Willow is having his fight, right? He's like fighting like the it looks like a grill.
The teapot thing, yeah. I don't know what it is.
Yeah,
yeah,
the
know.
Fucking pot.
That's
yeah,
a cool shot, too. It's how it like kind of is going around. It's kind of menacing, stuff like that. But he's fighting that. You have Man Mardigan is fighting the skull face soldier guy.
Kale.
Yeah, there's all these things. What is his name?
Kale.
Oh, Kale, yeah.
We were saying before, yep. The same actor from Raiders of the Lost Ark as the, the Nazi bald boxer,
the
bald headed, chopped up by the airplane. So,
yep,
one of his few roles,
one of the few boring, one of the boring scenes that Eric didn't like.
I didn't.
Just imagine, dude.
Maybe I need to go back.
It's
I
like
mean,
an
I
iconic.
Will. I will eventually.
Yeah,
I know. Shot. I know. Maybe I didn't give it a fair shot. But one thing I really liked about the ending and the whole, you know, because the what's her name there? What's the good?
Good witch is Finn Rizel.
Sorceress's name? Rizel. Yeah. Rizel gets knocked out. And so it's just Willow kind of left there with the baby. And I did like that he thought he had his trump card with the acorn. And
that
you know, Bad Ward is kind of selling it. She's like, oh, she's starting to turn to stone. And then she just reverses the magic.
Dude, he's got to learn how to throw shit, man. He threw it not even near her. She reached out and grabbed
she
it.
Caught it.
She's like,
she purposely caught it.
Yeah. Like, right. Motherfucker, what are you throwing?
But that was a good no sell there, because she starts a good turn and then she turns back and she's like, you fool. But then I really liked that Willow didn't just pull out some like again some magic spell that's gonna zap her or anything. He uses a little magic trick that he used back home on the farm to trick her. Yeah, I like that. And I'm like, you know, he's not using real magic there.
This baby will stay
her.
Still.
Mm-hmm. So I like that. I like that a lot. But I did. I thought the whole scene about, or you know, the reason or the way that the queen died was pretty.
That was
dumb.
A little weird.
Because you had this whole ritual, and apparently this ritual took like all night to do. Because she's doing this ritual with the baby to send her to the fucking to hell or whatever she's doing.
Never world, she said, or something. Yeah.
Yeah. And this, it's like taking all night to perform. And then at the last second, she accidentally spills some stuff onto herself, gets struck by lightning, and then she's gone.
Oh, is that what is
it?
Just
what
it
felt
is?
Weird
to
me.
I thought she ran out of time.
No, what I thought happened was she accidentally performed the ritual on herself to send herself, because she spilled like the blood that was on the little table on the floor, like around herself, and then the lightning struck her, and then that's what then like the whole red smoke swirled up around her.
Yeah,
and then
it took the wrong thing, so she gets sent instead of
So I was like, oh, that was weird, but okay. I don't know.
I wanted Willow to snap her neck and kick her out of the window.
That would have been cool. Badass.
Cut her head off. Yeah, you want the Northman scene out of nowhere.
Say, like, Willow cuts take her head off.
Stick it up her, between her legs.
Yep. Willow gets stabbed through the heart, and then they both die at the same time. No one.
They both fall out of the castle window, you know, holding hands, and yeah.
Well, I don't know. I'm sure you won't see this movie ever again. Maybe you will. Maybe one day.
When your kid gets old enough, I think it's.
I will
it's
say
a good thing to watch for your kids.
I will say, I watched the trailer for the new show, and it looks fucking awesome. It does look good. I think it looks really, really good.
The budget is impressive.
Well, now you got like the.
And they got as many people as they could get back for that, which is cool.
You got the grounding to it. It's kind of sad that Val Kilmer can't be in things anymore, really. I really wish.
It's a tragedy.
Yeah, that's a bummer.
That could, at least this role, of all roles, man.
Well, I noticed a couple people from other Disney things that were in that. I'm going to look that up right now.
Well, it was that chick with the freckles that was in Solo.
She was also in.
Falcon and the Winter Soldier.
Thank you.
Yep. And she's a recurring.
She's a Disney person now.
Yep.
At this point. Who else do we got? Warwick Davis, Ruby Cruz. Don't know her. Erin Kellyman. That's the freckle girl. Ellie Bamber is Dove. Joan Whaley, who plays Sorsha, who comes back for that role.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I saw one of the brownies comes back too.
Yep.
I thought both of them did.
Oh, maybe.
Yeah, because I just rewatched, or I just watched the trailer for the first time.
It's a good trailer. This.
Dude, it like got me. It's weird because I watched this movie and then I watched the trailer and I'm like.
Because you can appreciate what they're doing, though.
Yeah.
Because if you're a fan of this movie, George Lucas wrote this. He wanted it to be like a trilogy. He never got it. You know? And he had
it just feels like they're like completely, you know, blowing out and expanding the world to make it this huge epic thing. And especially now that they're making it into like a series, they can spend more time with the characters and building out the world even more. I'm excited about.
There's a world. I mean, there's like unique character names. Like the names are interesting. There are, you know, there's sorceresses, there's trolls, there's all these different monsters, there's cool names for like different regions and prophecies. Like the potential is there, and I would like to see. Is I don't know if George Lucas is even part of this.
I don't think so.
No, right?
I don't think he's it's being produced by Lucasfilm, but I don't think he has any hand in the story or anything.
Yeah, because the books that he had made, he had sequels in book form to Willow, and Mad Mardigan and Sorsha are like killed off in the beginning of the second the first book. Yeah.
Damn.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, there's like a whole villain that comes through and starts wiping shit
out. Cold-blooded. You can't kill Mad Mardigan off like that.
Oh, I know.
How dirty. It's like Han Solo dying at the beginning of Empire. Like, you can't.
Exactly. Fuck. Like, what are we doing here?
I will say that Warwick Davis is looking. He's aged well. Like he looks good in the role. Like he's got the long hair and stuff in the
He's believable as like a powerful sorcerer in the trailer. And I'm like I'm excited to see how, like, cuz it's supposed to be 20 years after it's only supposed to be 20 years in the canon of the movie. Yeah. 20 years after the original movie. But obviously he's, you know, he got the book at the end of the movie. With like the spell book and everything. So he's obviously in the new series, he's going to be much more experienced as a sorcerer.
He did the apple trick where he threw in the air and he did the dove thing.
Mm-hmm.
So he knows. He's actually, I didn't know this. He's born in 1970. So he's what, 52?
Yeah. He's not that old. He was only a kid when he was on the set of Return of the Jedi as Wicket. You know?
Yeah, it looks like
9 years old or something like that.
They swapped in their own new Mad Mardigan character, like kind of looking guy. Indian guy.
Oh yeah, he's like, it's the same
stereotype, suave, kinda, like, yeah.
Yeah.
So you got to have that like scoundrel. Classy scoundrel humor in it too. So yeah, I'm definitely excited for this.
Yeah, now that I've watched the original movie, I'm much more excited for the series and just watching that trailer. And that only comes out in a couple weeks on November 30th.
That's why we're recording this today. Exciting.
Yeah, that's, man. Right. Get hyped.
It's always good to to catch up on and get a good refresher in before like the new stuff comes out. Make sure you get your I's dotted and your T's crossed.
Yeah, I mean, I had no interest really in watching the Willow show before watching this movie, but now that I've watched this, I'm like, I'm all on board. I'm on board for sure with the new show. So
maybe he's still carrying around his wife's hair. Who knows?
Who knows?
Kyla! Kaya! When he yells her name every time, I'm like, oh my God.
Kaya! Yeah. She might even be in this. I think Migash or whatever his buddy is in this or something. I don't know. I recognize some faces in the trailer.
I think his wife is in this.
Yeah.
I think there's like one split second shot of them hugging in the trailer.
Dude, it's like Karate Kid, honestly. It's just like, let's take like this movie, you know, from the 80s and just here we are years later. And this one feels good because people that were fans never got anything. You know,
that's true.
And
this is the type of,
it's a Lucas thing, man. It's like Lucas world. Like, let's
get some NES games, some coloring books, maybe some other books, and that's about all you got.
Yeah,
I think something like this is perfect for a series, especially since, like we said, the world is so rich. I think there's more stories to tell there. So.
I'm excited. The troll design is better.
I think they got the money for it now.
I think they're in the trailer. I think they do show a troll, and it looks way different much better.
Out of it.
Yeah,
IMDb does have Christian Slater on this show as well. So who knows?
Yeah,
they don't have any. Mm-hmm. Like most people have, like how many episodes they're in, but he doesn't have anything by his name. So I don't know what his involvement is here. But yeah, it looks pretty sweet. Comes out on November 30th, 2022. So. Just after Thanksgiving.
Disney Plus,
yes.
Okay. Well, I think we're at the end of our adventure, guys. We're back. We're back with all of our friends. That was a lot of fun hanging out with Mad Mardigan and Sarsha and killing some evil queens. Cue the music. It is time to go into Act 3. I have a little game. A 5 in 10.
10. I don't remember this one.
Yeah, is that a returning game? I don't remember that one either.
It's name 5 things in 10 seconds.
Oh shit, this game. All right.
Oh, here we go.
Can't wait for this.
Yep, let's go. Yeah, I already said this. The game is called 5 and 10. So you just got to name 5 of this specific thing. Well, not specific, but this thing in 10 seconds.
This is an oldie. We didn't play this in a while.
I was going to say, it's classic.
And we'll decide who goes first. And then whoever has the most at the end wins. All right? So I have two for each of you. So each of you are going to give me as much as you can of this thing that I'm going to ask you in 10 seconds. Okay? Okay. To go first, 0 through 10, what number do I have picked in my head? Dave.
2.
All 2? Right. All right. I'll do Price is Right rules and say 3.
Dirty. Okay. Lame. It's a dirty move because Eric. It is lame. Eric's gonna take it.
I always get prices righted.
So it was 8. Okay. Well, I'm sorry because this is probably one of the more harder ones.
Oh boy, so, here we go.
Dave, if you wouldn't mind, while I have Eric name 5 of this.
Maybe the timer.
You might want to Google it real quick. Just a fact check, because it could be of anything. It's 5 out of any, out of anything, and I don't know everything on each of these questions. But all right,
oh boy,
you have 10 seconds. So I'm going to do the countdown.
Okay.
So wait, do I have to name 5 or just as many as I can?
As many as you can. I just want to make sure that because Dave is your opponent, he gets to fact check it.
All right.
Here we go. And I'll be too busy worrying about time. So and we'll swap roles so you can fact check against Dave and all that stuff. Okay. Eric. Name 5 movies that have, and I want full title, and it's not this movie.
Oh, no.
That has Warwick Davis in it.
I'm fucked. is the timer started? You didn't say yes. Go.
Go.
Okay. Star Wars Episode 6, Return of the Jedi. That's literally the only one that I know. So that's it.
Really? Okay. All right.
Oh, Eric, come on.
I know.
Yeah. I know at least one fan? More. Harry Potter.
Oh, hey, Harry Potter. Potter. Yeah, but which one? Like any of them? I don't remember.
I don't know. 5. I forget the name of his character in it though. He was the goblin.
I was gonna say I don't think I would have gotten that.
What is the goblin's name? I forget it.
How many movies has Warwick Davis even been in, like, as a main character, or something that I would recognize him from?
There's a few. Well, anyways, you get one.
I don't have a listing of his movies. Actually, it's weirdly enough, they just have a listing of his Star Wars characters on. Wikipedia.
Well, that's a bullshit question.
Well, just so you know, you could have named Harry Potter movies and Star Wars movies. There's 2 Ewok movies that he was also in.
I could have named any of the Leprechaun movies because he played Leprechaun. The Leprechaun.
To the Galaxy, Chronicles of Narnia.
Yeah. Which I did not know.
He was also in Solo.
He was the Leprechaun.
He was in Solo. He's in almost every Star Wars.
He was in Solo?
Oh, yeah. He was one of the Raiders at the end.
The girl with the freckles? When they all think. Yeah. So I know now you, that's why we do this. Okay. Could you freak out in 10 seconds? All right. Same thing. Ready? Now, Dave, you're probably going to do better than this, but we'll see. All right, Eric, if you want, you can fact check this guy. Dave, in 10 seconds, name 5 movies that have Val Kilmer.
Top Gun. Val Kilmer, Batman Returns, Batman Forever,
10.
I was gonna say The Saint, but I was late there.
That was 2.
Yeah,
Heat.
Saint.
Heat.
Yeah. Oh, I forgot about Heat.
Yeah. You'll be my Huck. I'll be your Huckleberry, right?
Oh yeah, Tombstone or something. Fuck. There's so many. Yeah, it's. Paralyzing under 10 seconds.
Yeah, true. 10 seconds is tough.
Yeah. You would have gotten probably the 3rd one if you didn't mess up getting the wrong Batman movie. And Eric was gentlemanly enough to let that slide. He corrected you because
aunting me. I wouldn't have.
Yeah, he could have just let that.
Could have
slide
said no. Said, that's like, true.
By the way, you're wrong, motherfucker.
I'll give you that courtesy if I can here.
Okay.
How quick
so there you go. Right. 2-1. Interesting. 2-1. Okay.
Oh,
okay.
Boy.
All right. Going back to you, Eric. Name 5 movies that have been directed by Ron Howard. Go.
Oh, my God. I'm drawing a blank. Solo is 1. Oh, fuck. This is. I can't think of any other ones.
There's a lot of.
That's like, the only one that like popped into my head.
Side ones. This is really tough, actually.
It is tough. Didn't he do
Da Vinci Code and Backdraft and Apollo 13?
There's a lot of ones you don't expect. Yeah.
Didn't he
Mind, How the Grinch Stole Christmas?
Did he do Apollo 9?
Apollo 13. Yeah. Which I didn't know. I mean, Splash. I love that movie, but I didn't know he directed that.
I really love Splash, right? Or no? Sure. Is that the one with the mermaid that comes
That's
to
the
life?
Mermaid, yeah. Tom Hanks mermaid one, which I didn't know
I'm
that
thinking, I was either. Thinking of Mannequin in my head. That was a good one,
Oh,
too.
Man. What are we, tied at 2-2?
For now, yeah.
It's a barn burner.
Da Vinci Code? Man. Oh, he directed, The Grinch, too? The Jim Carrey Grinch?
Yeah, a lot of these ones, like I have like Angels and Demons and shit like that. Like I would never.
I was gonna say there's a lot of obviously ones that I've seen, but I just didn't know that he directed them.
Well, all right, so Dave.
I need one
final question. Final question. Yep, 10 seconds. Name 5 characters who are not Willow or Mad Mardigan from this movie. Go.
Oh,
Sorsha, Finn Rizal, I forget that guy's name. Eric, the other guy. I don't know. I was trying to.
It's okay. You already won. You got it.
Yep.
That one was easy though because it was because we just talked about it. So.
All right. Well, I'll tell you what. I'll give Eric the bonus one just to see if he can redeem himself a little bit here. There wasn't one in case there was for some reason a tiebreaker. Eric, in 10 seconds. Outside of Willow, name 5 wizards in 10 seconds. Go.
5. Gandalf, the Great. Gandalf the White. Are those 2 separate ones?
Nope.
Same person.
Same person.
You're embarrassing yourself.
Harry Potter. I could just name it Ron Weasley. Let's just go down to Harry. Snape. Dumbledore.
Merlin is shaking his head. He's a famous one.
I just now right. I just would have just got stuck on Harry Potter.
No, that's fine. I didn't make any rules on franchise. I was hoping you guys would use that.
That's funny.
All right. Well, congratulations, Dave.
Woo!
You get to go to wizard camp.
Ooh. Sorcery school, Hogwarts, wherever you learn magic.
How to make pigs disappear.
Yep. That was fun. Thanks for playing, guys. Eric, if you don't mind, plug in some social and then we can get out of here.
Sure. If you want to follow us on our travels, you can follow us at Nomads of Fantasy on Twitter and Instagram. You can email us nomadsoffantasy@gmail.com with any comments, questions, all that good stuff. You can join our Discord at thenomadsoffantasy.com/Discord. If you want to get in there, chat with us, ask us questions, submit some questions to our Ask a Nomad special next week. Also find that Google form on Twitter as well. Submit your questions there. We would love to hear from you. And that's all I got. So with that, safe travels, Nomads.
Some black root. She loves it.
Black root? I am the father of 2 children, and you never ever give a baby black root.
Well, my mother raised us on black root. It's good for you. The tear on your chest, doesn't it, Dick?
Her name is not Stick. She's a Laura Dannon, the future Empress of Tyrus Lee. And the last thing she's gonna want is a hairy chest.
Did you see what he did? He stole our black root.
I'll get some more, don't worry about it.